In the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, here's the oral argument on California's ban against same-sex marriage. In the November 2008 elections, California voters approved Proposition 8, an amendment to California's constitution that limits marriage to a man and a woman. The court will decide if a lower court rightly struck down the voter-approved ban as unconstitutional. From San Francisco, this is 2.5 hours.
We'll proceed with this morning's calendar. The two cases, first is Perry versus Hollingsworth and County of Imperial. Please proceed.
Good morning, Your Honor, and may it please the court. My name is Charles Cooper. I represent the appellants in number 10-16696.
Nice to see you again, Mr. Cooper.
It's a pleasure to be here, Judge Reinhart. Thank you very much. The appellants are official proponents of Proposition 8 and the official campaign committee, ProtectMarriage.com. There are two jurisdictional issues before the court this morning. The first one is whether this court has jurisdiction to review the merits of the district court's decision striking down Proposition 8 as unconstitutional. And the second jurisdictional issue is whether the district court itself had jurisdiction to enter a sweeping statewide order enjoining enforcement of Proposition 8 on behalf of all same-sex couples, despite the fact that the complaint itself was brought by four individual plaintiffs seeking relief on behalf of themselves without any claims on behalf of a class nor any request for class certification. Speaking to the standing issue, Your Honor, the question is whether the proponents have standing or whether Imperial County has standing, and Mr. Tyler will speak to that issue momentarily. With respect to the proponents, we submit that this issue is controlled by the Supreme Court's decision in Karcher against May. In that case, plaintiffs brought a First Amendment challenge to a moment of silence law in the state of New Jersey, a 1983 suit. They sued the state's education officials, state and local education officials, and no one else. The Attorney General in that case and the state and local education officials declined to defend the moment of silence statute. And in the default of the official defendants, the court allowed the Speaker of the Assembly and the President of the Senate, on behalf of the legislature, to represent the state's interests in defending its statutes. The Supreme Court rejected the claim that the Speaker and the President of the Senate were not proper parties defendants, that they did not have standing. And the reason they did was because the New Jersey Supreme Court had previously, in a case called Forsyth, allowed the legislative officers to intervene on behalf of the legislature to represent the state's interests in defending a statute in that case. That was a redistricting statute.
Was that before or after Arizonans for Official English? The case you just referred to.
The Karcher case?
Yes.
Your Honor, that was before Arizonans.
So it couldn't have discussed Judge Ginsburg's statement in Arizonans that the court has never allowed the proponent of a ballot initiative to have standing, Article III standing.
That is true, Your Honor. It could not have, but the proponents in this case are really in precisely the same shoes as the legislative officers were in the Karcher case. Because, Your Honor, under the law of the state of California, the proponents, in fact, proponents of initiative measures are routinely and regularly allowed to intervene to defend the measures that they have proposed and advocated.
State court proceedings.
Yes, Your Honor, in state court proceedings.
What's your best case for allowing a proponent of a ballot measure Article III standing in federal court on appeal?
Your Honor, I don't have a case for allowing a proponent Article III standing. I am here advocating that this case be one that allows proponents Article III standing to defend.
Justice Ginsburg said, and it may have been dicta, but said in the Arizona case that she wasn't aware of any Arizona case which afforded standing to the proponents. Do you believe that there is a California case, or she said actually Arizona law, which may have included not only a statute but a Supreme Court ruling, or may not, but are you aware of any California law which states that the proponents do have standing?
Your Honor, in fact, the case of Strauss, which involved these very proponents being allowed to intervene to defend the validity of this very proposition, is, we would submit, directly on point and is precisely analogous to the Forsyth case.
Well, but Strauss really didn't talk about where you as proponents are agents of the state. Strauss only talks about you as proponents as agents of your proposition. We're in a different situation here.
Your Honor, Forsyth itself talked about the legislative officers being allowed to intervene on behalf of the legislature in that case as authorized to represent the state's interests.
Let me ask you a question, a little bit different question. Mm-hmm. There's no question the Attorney General has a duty to defend all the causes to which the state or any state officer is a party in his official capacity. Did you ever seek an injunction or an order or anything suggesting that the Attorney General should appear and appeal? And if in fact he did not appeal, allow you to appeal?
Your Honor, we didn't seek to enjoin or otherwise method the Attorney General to exercise
his... Well, if the Attorney General has the power to do it in his official capacity or a duty to defend all causes to which the state is a party, wouldn't that have been an appropriate way for you to have made sure of your ability to seek standing here?
Your Honor, we
didn't urge... someone do that? Didn't someone go to the California Supreme Court and seek to compel the Attorney General to appear?
Judge Reinhart, I believe you're correct. A lawsuit was brought. It was not one that we that I or my clients were in any way involved in, and the suit was unsuccessful. But the point, I guess, Your Honor, I would make is that I have little doubt that in the Forsyth case referenced in Karcher, that the Attorney General there also clearly had authority to defend the New Jersey statute at issue there and to take an appeal, but that Attorney General declined to do that. The New Jersey Attorney General declined to do that, just as the California Attorney General in this case has declined to do it. And yet, in Karcher, the United States Supreme Court recognized that the legislative officers had had the authority to not only intervene at the trial level and defend the moment of silence statute, but also to notice and take an appeal, and that they were proper to, parties, not just in the trial court, but also in the Third Circuit. And again, Your Honor, I would urge the court that that the law, the state law, relied upon by the Karcher court as demonstrating that the legislative officers in that case, had authority to represent the state's interest in defending a statute was a New Jersey Supreme Court decision, just like the California Supreme Court decision that we submit establishes the law on which we rely. That is, the law, in fact, involving these very proponents, where the California Supreme Court allowed these proponents to intervene in the Strauss case and to defend the constitutionality under the state constitution, just like Forsyth, to defend the constitutionality of Proposition 8, when no one else would do so. All of the state defendants refused to defend that statute, or at least, and in fact, challenged the constitutionality of that statute. The only party defending the constitutionality of the statute across the board in Strauss were these proponents. And in that case, I hasten to add, the California Supreme Court denied intervention status to another group, a group that was not the official proponent of Proposition 8, but had been an active group involved in the campaign itself and sought to come in and intervene as well. Now, in the Strauss case, also, at the Court of Appeals level, it wasn't in the Strauss case, it was in the marriage cases, at the Court of Appeals level, the Court of Appeals denied intervention to a group that was not the official proponents, but it stated that we make no ruling with respect to whether under our law the official proponents would be authorized in the default of the state officials, in lieu of state officials who have declined to defend, would be authorized to come in and represent essentially the state's interest in defending a state statute. So they recognize the distinction.
One further question about the earlier discussion about whether anyone tried to get the court to compel the Attorney General. That was a writ of mandate suit, as I recall. Did the court say anything about that or just denied?
Judge Reinhart, forgive me. I don't have the a specific recollection of the court's ruling in that case.
Better to say you don't know than to guess.
All right. Well, we can certainly check that.
Yes.
Go ahead. Yes. Go ahead. You know, there are two of you arguing in this half hour, so yes. I guess you'll each save whatever time you want. Is it? Or did we say you only one would respond?
You designated that only one of us would be eligible to
respond. That was a wise decision.
Well, and in the light of that directive, and in light of the fact that I'm at the podium first, I would like to reserve the balance of my time, which is just a couple of minutes, for rebuttal.
Certainly.
Thank you.
Sorry for this delay. May it please the court. My name is Robert Tyler. The plaintiffs think that justice is served where appellate review is frustrated in this case, where the state defendants circumvent any defense to state law that they're politically opposed to.
Well, I don't think they're talking about justice. They're talking about procedural rules.
So, yes, Your Honor.
Why don't you start by telling us where Dolores Provencio is?
I'm sorry, Your Honor. Could you repeat that?
Could you tell us where Dolores Provencio is? You know who she
yes,
is.
Yes, Your Honor.
She's the clerk.
Yes, Your Honor. She is. She's not our client. I cannot speak on her behalf. The fact is that the deputy clerk, Ms. Vargas, is a commissioned officer. She is the under the California Family Code and the Government Code, she is a civil commissioner of marriage. She has all the same responsibilities. In the county of Imperial, there are two persons.
Is there anything in the record to suggest that she's acting with the clerk's authority?
Your Honor.
The answer is no, isn't it?
There's nothing that says that the clerk has designated her. We have a declaration from our supervisor, one of the supervisors of the county. We have her. We have the declaration of Ms. Vargas that specifically says that she has these responsibilities. And I'd like to add and remind the court that this, in a petition to intervene, the court is to assume the facts to be true. And
well,
Ms.
what
Vargas
facts
is,
can we assume about the fact that there's nothing in the record to indicate that your client, Ms. Vargas, has any authority whatsoever to attempt to intervene in the litigation?
In her declaration, she says she has responsibilities.
You're repeating yourself now.
Well, Your Honor.
But there's nothing in the record to indicate that she's acting on the authority of the clerk, correct?
Nothing that says she is acting on the authority of the clerk. That is correct. But
is the clerk in Imperial County elected or appointed?
Your Honor, the clerk is, as I recall,
you don't know
it is appointed. She is appointed, Your Honor.
By whom?
And she's appointed by the Board of Supervisors. And in this particular case, Your Honor, what's important is it's the fact that the official duties of an officer are altered as a result of the outcome of the case.
Well, just a minute, if we could. It seems to me that if I read a 1922 case out of California, Fout versus Hernie, it says all political functions of an office remain vested in the county officer who would continue to exercise them himself when present. And in the absence, they would only be exercised by the deputy in the name of or as an act of the principal. So I guess I'm again worried that this clerk can only act as an agent of the principal, and if the clerk isn't here, we have a problem.
Well, Your Honor, I would disagree because the cases.
You disagree with Fout?
Your Honor, I believe that the government code is provides the ability to commission other persons within the clerk's office.
Well, there's
that
no
it
question they have the ability to commission. However, their ability to act is what we're really about here. And given Fout, which was about what deputies may do, or given Sartor versus Siskiyou County, given what deputies may do, in both of those cases, they suggest they're only mere agents of the principal.
Your Honor, I understand. But the fact is that this is a government position. This is a person who has duties that are designated by the California Family Law Code, designated by the California Health and Safety Code. These are acts that this person is carrying out. And as a result, her duties will be altered. She is enjoined by the court's injunction. She is.
Is it your position that she's bound by the injunction?
Yes, Your Honor. She is.
I thought your brief said exactly to the contrary.
No, Your Honor, if I may clarify, the fact is that Judge Walker's order binds her. Judge Walker's order says that all persons under the control and authority of the state registrar are to be bound. Judge Walker, in his denial of intervention, specifically said that all county clerks are subordinates or under the supervision and have no authority to disregard
that's not
the
correct,
state officers.
It's not correct that she is under the authority of the registrar. I thought she was an independent officer.
Yeah, and Your Honor, that we believe is correct. However, the fact of the matter is Judge Walker issued an order.
A different question, whether Judge Walker thought that she was bound in that capacity as a subordinate of the registrar. And that may lead you to a different theory, that because she thinks she's bound, she has a risk of being held in contempt, and that may give her some ground to complain that she is bound or in risk of being bound. But as far as actually being bound, her marriage capacity, she is, I understood your position, is an independent officer of the state with duties that are set forth in the code, and she's not subordinate to the registrar. Isn't that correct?
That is right, Your Honor, in the fact that we believe that as a in her official duties under the Family Law Code to issue marriage licenses, to perform marriage ceremonies, and to determine the statutory requirements, to determine whether or not the statutory requirements are satisfied with when an applicant comes before her, she comes under the supervision of the Board of Supervisors.
Well, let me ask you a question about that. Are you suggesting the clerks are state officers?
Your Honor, they are statutory officers.
Are they state officers performing state functions?
No, Your Honor, they're local.
They're not state officers?
I believe that they are local officers. They are individuals who are statutorily offices that are statutorily created under the government code.
How do I get around the language in Lockyer, which suggests they are state officers in this duty that they undertake?
Well, they do come because they're performing a state function, and that is the issuance of marriage license, which is a statewide concern.
So they're state officers as they do that?
Your Honor, I would concede. I'm not sure that necessarily is what this case turns on, because what the case turns on is whether or not, in her capacity at the local level, whether or not her duties will be altered as a result of the outcome of this case.
Let me, if you really are insistent upon that, let me turn to some language in Lockyer. It says, if, however, the controlling rule of law requires an official to carry out a ministerial duty dictated by statute, unless and until the statute has been judicially determined to be unconstitutional, it follows that such an official cannot compel a court to rule on the constitutionality of the issue.
Your Honor, I...
That's the language.
That's right, and Lockyer stands for a very important proposition here. In that situation, the City and County of San Francisco is attempting to violate the law. The County of Imperial stands here today uphold the law.
This is a question with, I understand, the clerk's not attempting to get the court to make a ruling. The court attempted to make the clerk perform a duty. Lockyer was the opposite circumstance, wasn't it?
That is exactly right, Your Honor. And in Lockyer, what the court reflected upon
just a minute. Let's go a little bit further. If the clerks are the state officers and they cannot compel the court to rule, and the Attorney General has the duty to defend those officers, then why would the clerk have standing separate from the Attorney General?
Your Honor, let me refer you to a case, Richardson versus Ramirez. In that case, there were three clerks who were sued, and the Secretary of State in regard to registration of felons for purposes of voting. In that case, the Mendocino County clerk had the ability to take this case and defend where there were no other defenders. And that is what is so important about this case, is there is not a single governmental defender defending this action. And here we have a governmental defender who's willing to come to this court and wants to assure that they are not placed in the legally conflicted position that is the outcome of Judge Walker's injunctive order.
Suppose the voters of California passed a proposition that said in every case in which first-degree murder is charged, the prosecutor shall, without exception, seek the death penalty. A deputy county attorney in Imperial County didn't want to seek the death penalty. Could they challenge the constitutionality of the provision?
the deputy, in their individual capacity, could file an action and challenge it in state law. They could not, on their own, decide to violate the law, which is exactly what happened.
Suppose the opposite occurred. Suppose a U.S. District Court held that proposition unconstitutional, and a deputy county attorney in Imperial County who wanted to seek the death penalty in every first-degree murder case sought to intervene and sought standing on appeal. Would they have it?
I believe that a deputy attorney would have standing.
Does a deputy attorney have the same statutory duty that a deputy clerk has? What is the state code provision that authorizes deputy prosecutors to perform those duties?
Your Honor.
The same as the district attorney of the county.
Your Honor, in our particular case, Ms. Vargas has the same responsibilities as she has asserted in her declaration.
Under the code, she is given the same duties as the clerk.
She has the same responsibilities, and she has stated that in her declaration. And those are assumed to be true,
deputy prosecutor has the same authority as county attorney?
Your Honor, I've never been a deputy prosecutor.
All right, but why don't you say you don't know the answer?
I don't know the answer, but I don't think the case turns on that.
It doesn't matter whether it turns on it. When you're asked a question and you don't know the answer, say so.
As your colleague did. Well, let me ask you this question. Two county clerks were named in this lawsuit, Alameda and Los Angeles. Is that right?
That's correct.
And I believe both of them responding saying they didn't want to defend the proposition, or they were comfortable with a ruling that said it was unconstitutional. Am I correct so far?
Yes, that's right.
Could a deputy clerk in either Los Angeles County or Alameda County come into court and seek standing saying, I don't agree with my boss?
Your Honor, I believe they should have the ability if they have official duties.
However, long do you think he would last taking that action? I mean,
well, Your Honor, precisely the problem, and maybe precisely why we don't have any other governmental defenders coming to this court. When we have the County of Imperial, and we have a clerk who's saying, I perform these responsibilities on a day-to-day basis.
You have a deputy clerk. Let us not forget that.
Yes, Your Honor.
And we're left completely at mystery to know why the clerk is not before us.
Your Honor, again, I don't speak for the clerk herself. If she wanted to prohibit the deputy clerk from being involved in this case, she could have stepped forward and said so.
We just don't know, do we?
Your Honor, I don't believe that is an issue that this case should be decided upon, whether or not she's involved or not.
It is an issue that concerns some of us on the panel.
I can understand that, Your Honor.
We're wondering why there is not a single sentence in her affidavit saying that she's acting on the authority of the clerk.
Your Honor,
is she joined with the Board of Supervisors in this case?
I'm sorry, Your Honor.
Is she joined with the Board of Supervisors in this case?
Yes, the Board of Supervisors is involved.
Did you say before that the Board of Supervisors appoints the clerk?
Your Honor, I was mistaken. I was given a note that the clerk is elected. And as my time is coming to a close, if I may just conclude, I see my time is up.
Let me ask you one more question about this. I read Livingston versus Pacheco, a California case that suggests that the Attorney General is the only person to whom authority given by the law to appear for the people, but he may delegate the authority to appear. And in that case did you ask the Attorney General for the authority to appear?
We did not, Your Honor, and
you did not. Are not appearing for the people, I assume.
Your Honor, we are appearing on behalf of the county clerk, who have direct responsibilities to issue marriage licenses, just like the county clerks in every other marriage case that has been brought before court. It is the county clerks who are sued. And if I may conclude, Your Honor, the outcome of this case will alter my client's official duties. Ms. Vargas is bound by an injunctive order that has placed her in a legally conflicting position. Does she comply with the California Constitution, or does she comply with Judge Walker's order? And the cases are clear that that gives her not only a right to intervene, but standing in this case. Thank you.
Judge Walker say your client was bound by the injunction?
Your Honor, Judge Walker specifically said that our client has no authority to
You're not answering my question.
He did not say directly.
We're taking up other people's time. Yes or no, did Judge Walker say your client, Ms. Vargas, was bound by the injunction?
No, Your Honor, but he did so through two different orders, in my opinion. And he did so by saying that in the denial of intervention, that our client is essentially subordinate to the state registrar, and stating that they had, that my client had, Ms. Vargas had no authority to disregard.
And if he's in error about that?
Your Honor, we do believe that there is error, but he did in fact do that, and therefore my client is bound by the injunction.
All right, thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Mr. Cooper? Oh, I'm sorry, no. Who is Mr. Boies?
Yes, Your Honor.
Thank you.
May it please the court. My name is David Boies, and together with Theodore Olson, we represent the plaintiffs. Let me begin by answering one of the court's questions with respect to the effort to get a mandate requiring the Attorney General or Governor to appeal. That was simply a one-sentence denial. The court did not provide any further analysis. I also would like to just be certain the record is clear. The permanent injunction that was issued by Judge Walker below relates only to the official defendants and persons under the control or supervision of those defendants.
So now, if Judge Walker was wrong about the registrar controlling county clerks, then Ms. Vargas is not bound by the injunction, correct?
That is correct, Your Honor.
And if she's not bound by the injunction, how does she have standing?
We do not believe that she does, Your Honor. And we believe that this court's decision in City of South Lake Tahoe makes absolutely clear that individuals like Ms. Vargas, even if she were the actual clerk, which she obviously is not, would not have standing.
Are you saying that only the clerks of Los Angeles and Alameda are bound by this injunction?
No, Your Honor. In addition, the Attorney General and the Governor are bound.
But what about the clerks? The clerks issue the licenses. Are they bound by the injunction or not?
They are not directly bound by the injunction, Your Honor.
How are they bound if not directly?
Because it is up, as the court held, the California Supreme Court held in Lockyer, marriage is a statewide concern, not a local or municipal concern.
Yes.
The forms and the rules come from the state to the localities.
If the injunction were lifted, if this our stay was lifted and the injunction was in force, could the county clerk in San Diego County refuse a marriage license to a same-sex couple?
She could without violating this injunction. However, if she did so, then the Attorney General would, as the Attorney General did in Lockyer, act to make the enforcement uniform. That would be a state proceeding. In other words,
what would happen then is that no one is bound by this injunction other than the two counties. And if they want to enforce this court order, they have to go to state court, which would be free to determine the issue of gay marriage again, except maybe in those two counties. But you say the Attorney General can go to state court. Is that right?
Yes and no, Your Honor. Yes, that is right with respect to the two counties. However, with respect to the remainder of the state, under California state law, Article 5, Sections 1 and 13, give the power to execute the laws and enforce the laws to the governor and to the attorney general. And if, since the injunction does run not only to the two counties, but to the governor and the attorney general in their official capacities as well, those individuals would have the responsibility for making the law uniform.
But what does Ms. Vargas do? Is she supposed to run the risk of contempt I mean, her lawyer is sitting here today. I suppose after this proceeding is over, he will go tell her that in the opinion of plaintiff's counsel, that she's not bound by the injunction. What's she supposed to do?
Your Honor, if the court were to affirm the judgment below, or if the court were to hold that it does not have jurisdiction to reverse it, then two things would happen. The state defendants, the Attorney General and the Governor, would move to try to make uniform the law within California.
Where are they going to move this?
I'm sorry?
Where will they move?
Where will they move? They will move in the state courts, just like they did in Lockyer.
So we're back to where we started. We have a federal decree that's effective in two counties, and then the Attorney General can move to the state court, and we don't know what the state court will do.
No, Your Honor, I think we do know what the state court will do from Lockyer, because in Lockyer, what the state Supreme Court held were that the county clerks were just ministerial officials, and that they had to apply the law as set forth by the Attorney General and by the Governor. So what you would find is that that is an enforcement proceeding. I do not believe that enforcement proceeding would be necessary.
The state court and the Attorney General and the Governor could have skipped this whole proceeding and just said to all the county clerks, enforce the law, which we find to be, we find the proposition to be unconstitutional, and you go enforce it because we have decided that?
Not exactly, Your Honor. What happened was that we had the trial below before Judge Walker. Judge Walker has, after the trial and based on the trial, enjoined the governor and the Attorney General. Yes, Your Honor, exactly, all the defendants.
And that phrase was, the makeup of all defendants was chosen by plaintiff's counsel, and you chose to name only Alameda and Los Angeles clerks.
Yes, Your Honor, that is exactly right.
And you made no effort in district court to get a defendant class certified?
We did not, Your Honor.
Or a plaintiff class?
We did not, Your Honor. We proceeded exactly as...
And that was a knowing tactical choice. It's not that you forgot to name the other 50 or
no.
Whatever the number is, county clerks.
We could have done that, Your Honor. And we did not, just as the plaintiff in Romer, for example, did not proceed by class action. And indeed, just as the Lockyer case was not a class action, where the California Attorney General proceeded against the city and county of San Francisco.
Who were the only ones violating the law as they conceived it?
Exactly, Your Honor.
I don't understand your answer, other than that, as of now, nobody is bound except the two clerks in Los Angeles and Alameda.
No, Your Honor.
No other clerks are bound.
No other clerks are directly bound. That is true. But because all clerks, all of the county clerks, are ministerial officials who simply issue marriage licenses to whoever the state determines is entitled to marriage licenses. That is simply a ministerial function. That function is the same before or after this court's decision.
Well, then why did you need anything to tell that to the clerks? If the Attorney General can tell the clerks what the law is and they're ministerial, or the governor can, you didn't need this case at all.
No, Your Honor, we did need this case, because in the absence of this case, the Attorney General and governor would not have told
I think at least the Attorney General would have told him that. I thought he made it pretty clear that he knew what the law was.
I think, Your Honor, that the Attorney General perhaps would have liked to have told him that, but I think that in the absence of a judicial determination that was the law, I don't think the Attorney General would have. And indeed, both the Attorney General and the governor have continued to enforce this law while this case has been proceeding. That is, this court stayed the district court decision, but they could have, based on the district court decision, tried to change the law in California. They've not done that.
Let me ask you a question about that. And it's my understanding that these particular initiatives could not have been vetoed by the governor, correct?
Yes, sir.
It's also my understanding that the legislature could not even amend them unless approved again by the voters.
That is correct, Your Honor.
So if that's so, I guess my problem is that, in fact, the governor's actions and the attorney general's actions have essentially nullified the considerable efforts that were made on behalf of the initiative to be placed on the ballot and obtain passage.
Your Honor, I would disagree with you for the following reason.
They don't appeal, and therefore no one can appeal. Haven't they effectively nullified the effect?
Only in the sense, Your Honor, that in every standing case, if a state official does not appeal, it, quote, nullifies it. For example,
the
honest answer to that is yes. Because what we really have here then is we have an attorney general and a governor with no ability to nullify acts of the people, and then by just not appealing, they in fact do it.
That what they do, Your Honor, and I think the distinction is important, is that they do not appeal a federal district court decision after a trial finding that it's unconstitutional. That's exactly the same thing that happened, for example, in Diamond against Charles.
Well, but I guess my worry is that by suggesting they won't appeal, are they really suggesting they're not willing to enforce the initiative?
No, Your Honor, because...
Why?
Enforcing it right now.
Suggesting that they're doing what they need to do at the present, but they've in fact says, I give up. I don't care. It's over. I'm not going to enforce.
And I agree that that is so, Your Honor, but what I suggest to you is that that is true in every standing case. Every time the United States Supreme Court decides, as they did in Diamond against Charles, that because the state of Illinois officials have decided not to continue to defend after the initial decisions.
Well, they didn't defend at the initial level either.
I'm sorry, what?
They did not defend in the trial either.
No, I don't believe that's accurate in Diamond
against
Charles.
What did they do at the trial?
In Diamond against Charles.
No, no, in this case.
No, in this case, they did not actively defend
it. So they didn't defend, and what Judge Smith said to you, where the governor is not supposed to have a veto, the people are supposed to be able to elect to pass a proposition unless it's constitutional. No officials will defend the initiative. That does not seem to be consistent with the initiative system, where the people are allowed to pass a measure, and if the state doesn't defend it, it's just tossing in the towel. But,
Your Honor, with respect, I think there is a different issue as to who has standing to appeal.
Well,
and
but Judge Smith was asking you, this contrary to a system where the governor is not allowed to veto this measure, but he can, in effect, veto it if he and the Attorney General will not defend it?
Didn't Justice Ginsburg speak to this in Arizonans?
Yes, Your Honor.
I mean, Judge Reinhart and I were both on the official English case, and as it turns out, the wrong side.
I thought it was the right side. But
ultimately, the Arizona Supreme Court ruled exactly the way Judge Reinhart's opinion, but mm-hmm. he made that argument, and I thought it was a strong and engaging argument, but Justice Ginsburg didn't think a whole lot of it, did she?
I think that's exactly right, Your Honor. And the United States Supreme Court has many times, including in that case and in the Valley Forge Christian College case that we cited in our briefs, said that the fact that there's no one to defend does not give standing.
Well, my worry is not necessarily to the standing, but to another issue which is pretty vital to you, in the fact that they will not defend or will not even appeal to let those who would defend the initiative argue. Are they in fact not enforcing the statute?
Your Honor, I don't think so. And I think that that is a question of California state law in any event. That is not something that affects the jurisdiction of this court.
Do I have any California law directly on point? I didn't find any. If you want me to find some, I'll go look at it.
Okay. I think the only case, Your Honor, that I would ask you to look at in that respect would be the Lockyer case, which we referred to before.
Well, Mr. Boies, if the California law is not clear or does not at present specifically authorize the proponents, and what Justice Ginsburg said in her dictum was she didn't find any Arizona law that authorized it, why shouldn't we ask the California Supreme Court what the law is in California?
I believe that if this court believes it is unclear what the law is, that would be an appropriate approach. However, I would urge you that based on what both the California Appellate Court and the California Supreme Court said in the Proposition 22 litigation, that it is clear that whatever the intervention rights may be, they do not have standing.
They said the proponents don't have standing?
Proponents do not have, will not have standing. For example, in the Proposition 22 case,
yeah,
the fund that was involved.
But they weren't the proponents, were they?
Well, they were put forward as the proponents.
Well,
the petition,
that doesn't fool the court. They were not the proponents.
They were not the proponents. They were not strictly the proponents, Your Honor.
Well, see, I don't know what strictly means. They were not the proponents.
They claimed to be the proponents.
But they were not.
And
the best
I don't
could
think
say is one board member was on both.
Right,
I mean,
exactly.
That was the best.
That's the most you could say.
So I don't see what we would have to lose, do you, by asking the California Supreme Court certifying the question, and they can tell us very quickly if they'd like?
I think if you concluded that it was unclear, and if you concluded that that would in fact provide Article III standing, that would be the appropriate approach. I would urge the court that while that kind of authorization is a necessary condition, it is not a sufficient condition for Article III standing in any event.
Well, why, given what Justice Ginsburg said about the Arizona initiative, that what she wanted to know was whether under the Arizona law, the proponent would have standing. And in fact, I think they even asked the proponents to supply them with the Arizona law.
Yes.
Why do you think that wouldn't be enough?
In the Justice Ginsburg's opinion, after stating that in Karcher, state legislators were given authority, she said, however, these proponents are not elected officials, and this court has never recognized proponents. Now, she goes on to say that under Arizona law, they're not authorized to act, but she does not address what would happen if they had been authorized. And for example, the United States Supreme Court in Raines against Byrd, there you had an explicit authorization from members of Congress to come into court and challenge the constitutionality of a particular line item veto statute. The United States Supreme Court in Raines against Byrd said that is not sufficient to give Article III standing. So if that's not sufficient to give Article III standing, even if California were to permit proponents to intervene, and even if California were to permit proponents to have standing, That would not, in our view, Your Honor, provide Article III standing under the applicable decisions of the United States
Supreme
Court.
Well, if it hasn't been decided and by the California Supreme Court and the United States Supreme Court, rather than kill an initiative that the voters have passed, wouldn't it be advisable to attempt to get a legal answer to this question before saying, you know, we're going to let a district judge whose ruling is binding on a couple of county clerks make a final decision without finding out from the California Supreme Court and the United States Supreme Court whether they're standing, and then we can reach the merits? Would that not be advisable?
Your Honor, I would suggest that because it is so clear that in order to have an ability to invoke the jurisdiction of this court, the appellants here must have a personal, concrete, particularized injury, and they don't. There is nothing that the California court could say that would provide Article III constitutional standing to these proponents. It doesn't make any difference whether or not the California law or anybody else tries to give these people standing. Under the federal Constitution, the case and controversy clause of the Constitution, they don't have standing unless they have a personal, concrete, and particularized injury. The United States Supreme Court has held that over and over again. And the United States Supreme Court said even members of Congress, even if they're acting pursuant to a grant of jurisdiction by the Congress of the United States, do not have that Article III standing because they don't have that personal interest.
So you would, if we did certify this question to the California Supreme Court, and the California Supreme Court came back and said, reading the Constitution of California together, we don't think that it is appropriate that the governor and attorney general can effect veto a proposition. Therefore, we think under California law that it's appropriate for proponents of a ballot proposition to stand in when they refuse. That even if the California Supreme Court said what I just described, you would be back here arguing what you just argued.
We would, Your Honor. And I would say that if the California Supreme Court believed that in order to save the initiative, it had to be defended, the way for it to have done that would be to grant the mandate requiring the Attorney General to come in and do so. They did not do so. These appellants did not even ask them to do so.
Let me move to another question. If neither the proponents nor Imperial have standing, and therefore we dismiss the appeal, do we have any power or authority to address the scope of the injunction?
I do not believe so, Your Honor.
So you're suggesting then that there is no authority any place which would allow us to determine the scope of the injunction?
If the court concluded that the scope of the injunction was somehow beyond the subject matter jurisdiction of the court below, then I'm not prepared to say that the court does not have the power sua sponte to do something about it. But I do not believe that there is any precedent that I'm aware of for that.
You're saying, in any event, that the scope of the injunction is quite limited.
The scope is, Your Honor. It's simply
limited to two counties, and then you're counting on the Attorney General to go into state court and have state court expand the injunction to the other counties.
I wouldn't put it exactly that way, Your Honor, but I know what the
practical
court is saying.
It may not be the best legal terms, but that's the practical.
The practical terms is that we do have to depend on the governor and the attorney general.
Well, you're lucky the election came out the way it did.
perhaps, Your Honor.
Mr. Boyes, suppose we were to agree with the position, the panel were to agree with the position that you've just taken. Would Ms. Vargas be able to file a declaratory judgment action in the Northern District asking whether the injunction binds her or other county clerks?
I believe that she could do that, Your Honor. I believe she could do that.
And if the court determined that she was bound by the injunction, what would happen then?
Then she could have an appeal.
And she would have standing.
And she could have standing in that situation.
She would have standing.
Yes. I mean, I think that the court below, I would urge the court below, and I believe the court below, would interpret its injunction as applying only to the defendants in that case. So she would not be bound by, directly.
So
bound.
That's what you would argue, and if the district court agreed with you, then Ms. Vargas would be free to refuse marriage licenses in Imperial County to same-sex couples.
She would, except to the extent that the Attorney General and Governor of California move, as I believe they have an obligation to under the California Constitution, to make the marriage laws uniform throughout the state and to abide by the injunction that's been issued against them in the case below.
Why not bring all of these issues together and decide them right here?
Your Honor,
so that it's clear in California who has the right to marry and who doesn't,
right. And
what clerks are supposed to do when same-sex couples ask for the issuance of a marriage license.
Your Honor, that was exactly the situation that was addressed by the United States Supreme Court in Raines against Byrd, when the court said, we must put aside the natural urge to proceed directly to the merits of this important dispute and to settle it for the sake of convenience and efficiency. And what the court said is that constitutional standing serves so many important purposes that it is not open to the courts to simply say, let's get it all together, let's settle it now, that's the most efficient way to do it. There are important constitutional and policy reasons that underlie the standing requirements. Where it is clear, and I respectfully suggest to this court, it is crystal clear in this case. These appellants do not have standing.
It's hard to believe that you deliberately only wanted to get a judgment in Alameda and Los Angeles and didn't want to get a judgment that this was, that this judge's ruling applied throughout the state. But forget that. It's hard for me to believe that a lawyer with your ability and fame and whatever else you have, even if you lost to Mr. Olson. Nevertheless, it's hard for me to believe that. But let me ask you one other question. This marriage system we have in California is an integrated system. As you say, the state's supposed to give the clerk orders. Everybody does all these things. They all act in concert in a scheme to get two people married. It takes a lot of people to do this, but they're all acting together. Doesn't the injunction run to all of those who are acting in concert to perform, get this marriage done between two people? And aren't those people covered by the injunction because it covers all of those who are acting in concert?
Well, Your Honor, the injunction itself did not go as broad as it might have under Rule 65. The injunction itself is directed to defendants in their official capacities and all persons under the control or supervision of defendants. And that is the limitation of the injunction that was actually entered. One of the defendants that we haven't mentioned is the registrar. The registrar is the person who is responsible for the form and content of the marriage license. The registrar, the state registrar, who is the defendant here, will, under this injunction, have to change the form and content of that marriage license.
And for that reason, I'm some surprised by your answer to whether the clerk could even bring the motion for declaratory judgment. Because as I understand law here, the registrar puts together the form, the questions to be asked, all of the particular things that the clerk needs to know, and as I understand Lockyer, the clerk only completes in a ministerial way the forms. Therefore, only completing in a ministerial way the forms, how would the clerk then bring any set or appropriate case about what she's to do?
I think you're exactly right, Your Honor, and I don't think the court could. I think the one possibility, though, is that if the court were to say, I am concerned that the injunction that you have issued binds me before the registrar has even given me any further instructions or additional forms, she would have the narrow ability to simply ask the court whether the injunction binds her, the deputy clerk, directly or not. But I agree with Your Honor that the deputy clerk, or even the clerk, if the real clerk was here, would not have any standing to contest that issue or even litigate that issue. It is purely a ministerial function, as the court says. I would try to end with two points. One is that this case is, at the federal level, a reflection of what happened at the state level in the In Re marriage cases, in which you didn't have the clerks, you didn't have other defendants. What you had is the state defendants and the attorney general and the governor and the registrar as respondents. Those are the proper respondents. The appellants here do not have the personal, concrete, particularized injury that this court in the city of Lake Tahoe made absolutely clear it was the law, that the United States Supreme Court repeatedly has made clear is the law, that Justice Ginsburg's opinion, I think, makes particularly clear is the law. They do not have standing, and because they do not have standing, all of the other concerns, and they're legitimate concerns from a policy standpoint. We could have a different system of government where you didn't need this kind of standing. But those kinds of concerns exist in every standing case, whether it's abortion.
You're running over, and we know that the about how important standing is, but let me ask you one more question. Under Rule 65, anyone who is served, who is acting in concert with the people against whom the injunction is, people named in the injunction, all people who act in concert or participate with them are bound if they are served. Now, would that not apply to any clerk who is involved in the marriage business in California, in this group I described to you where it is an integrated process, so that would not anyone bound by the injunction have a right to appeal?
I think people directly bound by the injunction would have the right to appeal. I do not believe these appellants are directly bound by the injunction because the injunction makes clear who is bound. If they are acting in concert with somebody and we serve them with the injunction, which we have not done and would not do, then the issue would be whether that binds them or not. I did point out to the court that the form of injunction here does not use the in concert language. It talks about control and supervision.
No, I said the Rule 65 does. Right. It doesn't have to be in the injunction. The rule says that anyone who does that is bound And I'm not sure whether if you have knowledge that would be enough or whether you have to be served. You might serve them. That would help us clear up the case.
I think we'd probably decline that, Your Honor.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Now, Mr. Cooper, you must have a lot to say after hearing all of that.
I have a lot to say. I have little time to say it. But the one thing that to me is most important to say, Your Honor, is that you put your finger, I believe, precisely, Judge Reinhart, on the key point from Arizonans, as Justice Ginsburg distinguished Karcher. This is what she said, and this is the language I think you were referring to. She distinguished it this way. No one in Arizonans had identified any Arizona law appointing initiative sponsors as agents of the people of Arizona to defend, in lieu of public officials, the constitutionality of initiatives made law of the state. Well, in Karcher, what law from New Jersey did the Speaker and the President of the Senate bring to the Supreme Court? They brought a New Jersey Supreme Court decision allowing them, in the Forsyth case, to intervene and to defend a New Jersey a constitutional challenge to New Jersey state statute.
Excuse me, just one quick point. In Karcher, wasn't the state attorney general willing to defend?
The state attorney general did not defend. I don't believe he was willing to defend, except to the extent that the decision might result in attorney's fees against the state. He was willing to reserve some right to defend in that respect. But it is at least my understanding that the only individuals who took a notice of appeal, and that's what we're dealing with here, took a notice of appeal to the Third Circuit were the president and the speaker. And what law do I bring you? I bring you exactly the same law that the legislative officers brought the Supreme Court in Karcher, because I bring you the Strauss case, a case in which these very proponents were allowed to intervene in lieu of the state officials who did not defend the statute, allowed to intervene to do so standing alone, Your Honor. And certainly, Judge Reinhart, you, my time is expired, but I would like to conclude by saying, if you don't agree with me that we have standing by virtue of the analogy to Karcher, then I do urge you to ask the California Supreme Court this issue. You dismiss this case, stand a single district court decision, single district court judge decision, nullifying the will of the people of over 7 million Californians. Thank you very much, Your Honor.
Thank you, counsel. The court will take a brief 10-minute recess and will return for the second hour. Good morning again, ladies and gentlemen. We'll proceed to the second half of this consolidated proceeding, Perry versus Hollingsworth. Perry and City and County of San Francisco versus Hollingsworth. Good morning again, Mr. Cooper.
And good morning again to you as well, Your Honor. The people of California and Americans throughout the country are engaged in an earnest and profound debate about the meaning, purposes, and definition of marriage. The issue is a momentous one, for it goes to the very nature of an ancient and ubiquitous social institution that is, in the words of the United States Supreme Court, fundamental to the very existence and survival of the human race. So this court is presented with, in our submission, this fundamental question. And it is whether the definition of marriage, that momentous issue, is one for the people themselves to resolve through the democratic process, as they did in enacting Proposition 8, or whether our Constitution takes that issue essentially out of their hands and decides it for them, as the plaintiffs argue here.
Could the people of California reinstitute school segregation by a public vote?
No, Your Honor.
Why not?
Well, Your Honor, that would be inconsistent.
With what?
With the United States Constitution.
As interpreted by the U.S. Supreme Court.
Yes. Yes, Your Honor. And so the issue.
But they probably could have done that in 1870 or 80 or 90, right?
Very possibly, Your Honor. Yes, very possibly.
And how's this different?
Your Honor, this is nothing like the racial restrictions at issue in Loving, where there is simply no legitimate rational basis whatsoever on any purpose of marriage that one could possibly conceive to deny the right of a mixed race couple to marry. On every basis on which one can identify a purpose of marriage, a mixed race couple satisfied those purposes. So the question is:
Now you suggest that Baker would mandate that the state has an absolute right to prescribe the conditions upon which the marriage relationship between its own citizens should be created, correct?
Not an absolute right, Your Honor. We agree that that right is limited by whatever restrictions the United States Constitution may place on it.
Okay, so then Loving versus Virginia falls right into that restriction.
Directly, Your Honor, and the Supreme Court in Loving said that the racial restriction violated the central meaning of the 14th Amendment, both its due process clause and its equal protection clause.
So if I agree with that, then what do I say is the general notion when confronting Turner v. Safely or Safley?
The case dealing with the right of
the
prison
warden.
Inmates
right.
to marry. Your Honor, the central, I guess, point that we want to advance here is this: what is the distinguishing characteristics of opposite sex couples that are relevant to interests that the state has authority to implement?
Are you arguing to me that it's enough for a rational basis for the federal court to get involved in that right of marriage?
We are arguing that the test that applies here is a rational basis test, and that if there is any rational basis for the opposite sex traditional definition of marriage, then that traditional definition of marriage must be upheld. And only if this court concludes that there is nothing to say in favor of that, of the definition of marriage that has prevailed in this country and in all places, essentially at all times since time immemorial, there's nothing to say in defense of it, there's no rational basis for it, then this court would have to strike it down. But that is the test that we submit to you that applies, Your Honor. And we believe that there is clearly a rational basis justifying the traditional definition of marriage. The key reason that marriage has existed at all in any society and at any time is that sexual relationships between men and women naturally produce children. Society has no particular interest in a platonic relationship between a man and a woman, no matter how close, no matter how committed it may be, or emotional relationships between other people as well. But when a relationship between a man and a woman becomes a sexual one, society immediately has a vital interest in that for two reasons. One, society needs the creation of new life for the next generation. But secondly, society is its vital interests are actually threatened by the possibility that an unintentional and unwanted pregnancy will mean that the child is born out of wedlock and is raised by, in all likelihood, its mother alone. And that directly implicates society's vital interests, both in terms of its immediate interests, because society will have to step in and assist that single parent, in all likelihood, that is what usually happens, in the raising of that child, but as well in the undeniable fact that children raised in that circumstance have poorer outcomes.
Well, that sounds like a good argument for prohibiting divorce, but but how does it relate to having two males or two females marry each other and raise children as they can in California and form a family unit where children have a happy, healthy home? I don't understand how that argument says we ought to prohibit that.
Your Honor, the point and the question is whether or not the state of California has a rational reason for drawing a distinction between same-sex couples who cannot, without the intervention of a third party of the opposite sex, procreate, and opposite-sex couples who not only can procreate, but can do so unintentionally and create unwanted pregnancies. That is not a phenomenon that exists with respect to same-sex couples.
Well,
and the overriding.
But what is the rational basis for an initiative that, when California law really says that homosexual couples have all the rights of marriage, all the rights of child rearing, all the rights that others have, what is the rational basis then? If in fact the homosexual couples have all of the rights that the heterosexual couples have, we're left with a word, marriage. What is the rational basis for that?
Your Honor, you are left with a word, but a word that is essentially the institution. And if you redefine the institution, if you redefine the word, you change the institution. So it is you cannot separate the two. The name of marriage is effectively the institution, and the issue here is whether it will be redefined essentially to be a genderless institution that bears little or very no relationship to the traditional historic purpose of marriage.
Why aren't the merits of this case controlled by Romer? After all, before the proposition was passed in California, same-sex couples had the right to marry. The proposition takes it away. Isn't that exactly what the proposition in Colorado did?
Your Honor, in Romer, the court was dealing with a sweeping law that placed undifferentiated burdens and disqualifications on homosexuals.
So if you take away, if you take away a bunch of rights, that's bad. But if you just take away one right, it's okay.
Your Honor, it isn't a question of taking them away. The Supreme
Court
did
or did not same-sex couples have the right to marry before the passage of Proposition 8 in California?
Your Honor, the California Supreme Court affirmed that they did, yes. And the people of California disagreed with that, and the people of California reversed it.
How's that different from what happened in Colorado? A few local communities decided that they wanted to extend preferred status to individuals, homosexuals, gays, lesbians, et cetera. And the voters of Colorado passed a proposition saying you cannot do that. You have no right to do that. Stop doing that.
Your Honor, Amendment 2 rendered homosexuals strangers to the law. It essentially eliminated any and all protections for homosexuals with respect to the ordinary pursuits of civic life, as the court put it. It was a sweeping, undifferentiating, essentially rendered them an isolated class and strangers to the law altogether. The court stressed that it was an unprecedented in our jurisprudence kind of statute. The traditional definition of marriage, Your Honor, is anything but unprecedented in our jurisprudence. It has existed throughout the history of this country. It has been the governing understanding and definition of marriage in this state since its founding, and basically throughout the country and throughout the world for all time. The definition of marriage is not anything like the kind of statute that the court was dealing with in Romer. And in fact, in this case, I would submit to you that the question is, your question, Your Honor, is governed by the Crawford case, where the court said that it would refuse to interpret the 14th Amendment, and these are its words, to require the people of a state to adhere to a judicial construction of their state constitution when that constitution itself vests final authority in the people. And so,
but you've told us that the people of California could not reinstitute racial segregation in public education. So we know there are some things they can't do.
They certainly can't do that.
Without flying in the face of the 14th Amendment. Romer case opens with a quotation from Justice Harlan's dissent in Plessy. And here's what Justice Kennedy says. The Constitution neither knows nor tolerates classes among citizens. Those words now are understood to state a commitment to the law's neutrality where the rights of persons are at stake. Aren't you flying right in the face of that?
Your Honor, if there are no reasons, no rational reasons to distinguish between citizens, then the Constitution does not permit the law to distinguish between them and treat them differently.
The proponents of the ballot initiative in Colorado made the perfectly logical argument that all they were doing was leveling the playing field. And Justice Kennedy said, that's not right. Not correct.
And Your Honor, it wasn't right. They were doing much more than that. They were essentially opening gays and lesbians to private and public discrimination and disabling any governmental body from intervening in that private discrimination. As Justice Kennedy emphasized, in a common, every ordinary day civic life, from banking to hospitals to hotels to common carriers, all the ordinary pursuits of civic life. Homosexuals were rendered strangers to the law. They could be discriminated against in these fashions. That is a far, far more sweeping and different thing than simply adhering to the definition of marriage that has prevailed in California and everywhere else since time immemorial. The question comes down to this. Are there distinguishing characteristics relevant to an interest that the state has authority to implement at work in the opposite sex definition of marriage? And if there are, then the courts cannot say that acting upon those distinguishing characteristics is invidiously discriminatory.
Let me ask you a question. That's a terrific response. Let me ask you a question that's meant entirely to be neutral. Is it the preference of the proponents, let's assume for the moment that we conclude you have standing and you're here to argue, you're properly here and argue to defend the proposition?
I accept that assumption, certainly.
Okay. Do you want us to get to the merits of the issue here? In other words, do you want us to sidestep Baker?
No, not at all. And Your Honor, I believe that Baker is binding on this court. And my opening legal point would have been that that in fact this is not the first court to take up and deal with the very 14th Amendment issues that the plaintiffs bring here today. In fact, there have been 8 appellate courts, state and federal, who have addressed these issues, and insofar as they relate to challenges to traditional marriage laws, just like Proposition 8, and all 8 of those courts have upheld the traditional marriage laws and have rejected the 14th Amendment claims. And one of those cases, Your Honor, is Baker against Nelson, a Supreme Court case that we submit is remains a good law, remains binding on this court.
There are some differences. It was before Romer and Lawrence, and it didn't deal with the subject of repealing a constitutional right that existed at the time it was taken away.
That's a fair point, Judge Reinhart. That is a distinction with respect to the issue as it came to the Supreme Court in Baker. There had not been the period in which the Supreme Court had essentially legalized same-sex marriage. So that is a fair point.
The California court, sir, said that's what the Constitution says.
It said
that citizens, we have to accept that from that moment forward. It was not a matter of pulling rabbits out of a hat or something like that. They said this is what the Constitution says.
Your Honor, that's fair enough. They said this is what the state Constitution says. But under the California system, it is the people themselves who retain all the sovereign political governmental power, and they are free to review that decision, to disagree with it, and reverse it. And that's what they did in Proposition 8. And so, Your Honor, we would submit to you that the case came to the people of California the same way the case came to the California Supreme Court on review from a decision from the California Court of Appeals, a lower tribunal. And the California electorate disagreed respectfully with their Supreme Court in a 4-3 decision, and they reversed it. In the Crawford case, I would submit to you, Judge Hawkins, is on the point of this. That was another case where the California courts had interpreted the California Constitution, I believe it was, the California Constitution that they had interpreted to go beyond what the federal Constitution requires. And the people of California decided we're going to bring it back to the place that is required by the federal Constitution. And the court said in a state like California, where the people retain the ultimate power of the government.
Well, of course, generally, you can amend the Constitution. That's true. It depends on the subject and what you're amending. And I think that's what Judge Hawkins was talking about earlier. What is it that you are amending, and can you amend that? Nobody would suggest that you can't amend the California Constitution, no matter how the court had interpreted it, as a general rule. The question is, can you amend something as, I'm not suggesting it's a fundamental right for purposes of this discussion, but is there a valid reason to amend this Constitution under the standard that we follow?
Well, Your Honor, I believe that the point of Crawford is that the people are free essentially to disagree and reverse their
well,
Constitution.
Well, not anything, as Judge Hawkins was pointing out. You can't say, he asked you, I think, twice, could you say we're going to have segregated education? We couldn't say yes to that.
No, Your Honor, but that's because the federal Constitution would have outlawed that quite apart from whatever the California Supreme Court had to say about it, and so it wouldn't matter if the people did that before a California Supreme Court decision or after a California Supreme Court decision. If the California Constitution had provided that that there will be, you know, racial segregation, as you suggest, in connection with schools, the federal Constitution would outlaw that, and it wouldn't matter whether there had been an intervening Supreme Court decision from California also outlawing it. The point really is simply this: if Proposition 8 had been enacted before the California Supreme Court ultimately invalidated traditional marriage, if it had been enacted before that, the constitutional case that would come to you is the same as it is coming to you now with Proposition 8 having been enacted to reverse the California Supreme Court, because under Crawford, the people of California retain the authority to reverse their Supreme Court unless the federal Constitution is violated then and there by what they did. So
if you're taking away a right from a particular class without sufficient reason, let's just say using the standard, without any reasonable reason, and it's done for a reason that could only be directed at a class in a manner that is, I don't want to say invidious, but in a biased manner. And that's, you can sometimes derive that view of bias from the action in itself. Then you cannot do it. And here, you have to take into account all of the circumstances that Judge Smith mentioned, for instance. You have had all of the aspects of marriage other than the title. What is the reason for wanting to take that title away from a group of people who have enjoyed it? That's where I think you get to the constitutional question.
Well, Your Honor, and our submission to you is that the people of California needed no reason beyond the fact that they disagreed that their Constitution ordained that result, that their Constitution outlawed and invalidated the traditional definition of marriage.
Why isn't that true of Romer also, then?
I beg your pardon?
Why isn't that true of Romer? The people of Colorado decided that they wanted to do this, and that's what they wanted. This is the way the people of California did. But that there is a limit on that. And it doesn't have to be in the federal constitution, except that there has to be a rational basis for it, and it can't be related to bias.
Yes, Your Honor, that is true. And so if Proposition 8 was coming to you without there having been this previous period in which California had approved of same-sex marriage, it would come to you in the same constitutional profile that it comes to you now. I guess our point is it isn't changed because there has been this previous period where the California Supreme Court has interpreted the California Constitution to invalidate traditional marriage.
That's an interesting question, I think, in this case. Would it really be the same if the state did not go as far as California had gone? Would they be required to go that far? Or is it different when you're taking something away? I mean, that you can argue that there's no difference. And I'm not sure that's a settled question.
Well,
I would think that the other side, and I know the city of San Francisco particularly did, say it's different when you're taking it away than when you're not giving.
Well, and Your Honor, I am not. I don't deny that there is some force to that proposition, but I do commend to you the Crawford case, which we think does support the proposition that the people they act. If the California Court of Appeals had invalidated traditional marriage, and the California Supreme Court had reversed that and said, no, our Constitution doesn't do that, no one would say that during the interim that right had existed and the California Supreme Court had stripped the people of California of it. And what we are submitting to you, and we believe the Crawford case supports, is that the people themselves are a tribunal over their constitution, standing in those types of shoes.
Could the people of California suppose Proposition 8, in addition to addressing the subject of marriage, had done what in part the proposition in Romer did, which was to disallow civil unions? Would you have the same response? Could you have the same argument?
Your Honor, I believe that the argument I'm making here would be the same, but I do recognize that the argument for the constitutionality of a proposition that accomplished that result, or perhaps I should put it, the constitutionality of that result would be on different footing than Proposition 8 itself comes to you in.
It sounds like it's, you're a little uncertain if they had added civil unions. What if they had said, we don't want hospitals allowing visitation of dying loved ones by same-sex partners? Could they? And they added that to the proposition. Would that put it on shakier grounds?
This proposition I'm advancing now, no. The point being that any time a state goes beyond, and here I am assuming that this would go beyond what the federal constitution demands, and if it goes beyond what the federal constitution demands, then the people are free, according to the specific language of Crawford, having gone beyond the requirements of the federal constitution, a state is free to return to the standard prevailing generally throughout the United States.
So do I understand you to be saying if the proposition had simply done away with civil unions, Crawford would say that's okay?
If it had simply done away with...
The Proposition 8 had simply been addressed to disallowing civil unions, which as I understand it are allowed under California law? If that's all the proposition had said, Crawford would say that's okay.
Yes, Your Honor, to the extent that civil unions are not required by the federal constitution.
But yes. What does that mean, to the extent that? Does that mean they could take it away or they couldn't take it away?
They would be able to take it away, Your Honor, unless the federal constitution itself requires the states to afford civil unions to gays and lesbians. And that
How does that differ from Wilmer? They took things away in Wilmer that aren't required by the federal constitution. So there's more to it than your answer.
Well, no, Your Honor. I don't believe that that the things that were put in place in Romer, in fact, I think Justice Kennedy said this wasn't just a repeal of the provisions that had been enacted in Denver and other municipalities. And if, and he suggested if that's all it had been, it would not have been constitutionally objectionable. It went much farther than that, and in going much farther than that, it became constitutionally objectionable.
I didn't mean for you to stop your sentence. If I could have permission of the presiding judge here, there are a couple of questions that I am particularly worried about. Some states have not extended domestic partnership rights to homosexuals. Do they have a stronger argument for a rational basis than does California? And
Judge
I want
Smith,
to ask you that straight out because I'm trying to get you to differentiate your argument. It seems to me that your argument can be made as to rational basis if there weren't all kinds of rights already given to those homosexuals in domestic partnership rights. So I'm asking you straight out, some states haven't done it. Do they have a stronger argument then for rational basis than does California?
Your Honor, to the contrary, I think they do not. I don't think they have as strong as an argument. It would be quite perverse if the people of California, in enacting and addressing the very legitimate interests and needs of gays and lesbians and their families by enacting domestic partnership laws and going as far as a state can do short of redefining marriage and the state insisted in Proposition 8 that it not redefine marriage and that they preserve that institution for the specific purposes that it has always served. I don't believe a state, Judge Smith, has weakened its constitutional position when it goes as far as it can to address the interests of gays and their families.
I guess my worry is, and this is what I'm really worried about in your particular situation, if I adopt your argument, is that I'm trying to find the rational basis in this particular situation. When California has gone as far as it has, what is the rational basis that we really have? I'm wondering if it's just not to maybe market the marriage of a man and a woman.
Your Honor,
it's promote a special relationship in society. Is that enough to meet the rational basis?
Your Honor, I believe it's to preserve the institution of marriage for the purposes that it has always served, the unique purposes that flow from the unique interest that society has that in turn flow from the unique procreative natural procreative capacities of men and women. The courts that have upheld traditional definition of marriage have uniformly noted that it is entirely rational for, in fact, the Eighth Circuit in the Bruning case, dealing with a proposition from Nebraska that contained identical language to Proposition 8, that it was entirely rational for the people in that state to confer and retain the inducements and benefits of the institution of marriage for opposite-sex couples who can procreate, and including procreate unintentionally, creating unwanted pregnancies that threaten society's interests, and not extend marriage to same-sex couples who simply don't represent that same societal interest. The interests of society that are vitally implicated by sexual relationships between opposite-sex couples are simply not implicated in the same way. My time is
yes,
well
I was
past.
About I had, to tell you, but I wanted to see if Judge Smith was through with his questions.
Well, no? I'll skip the last question. Thank you. My last question was, do you think this rationale, since the good judge has given me opportunity, do you think this rationale would satisfy the more searching form of rational basis Justice O'Connor elaborated in Lawrence?
Your Honor, if this case is to be decided by heightened scrutiny, then obviously it is a harder case. But we think it does satisfy heightened scrutiny. The essential proposition, Your Honor, being that the main objection to the rationale that I've articulated here is that infertile couples are nonetheless allowed to marry. And that is true. No society has ever insisted that marriage produce children. But Your Honor, the question then becomes, how would society draw that line? How would society do that? It would have to have Orwellian measures designed to police fertility before marriage, Orwellian measures designed to presumably annul marriages that are not childless. We just don't think that, and those measures would undoubtedly violate the constitutional rights of the individuals involved. So we don't think that any less restrictive method could be, as a practical matter, employed. And I appreciate the court's indulgence.
Thank you, Mr. Cooper.
I think he indulged me, and I hope you didn't go too long so that he's aggravated with me. Thank you.
Well, you didn't save any time, but we'll give you 2 minutes anyway.
I appreciate that, Your Honor.
May it please the court. My name is Theodore Olson. I'm here on behalf of the plaintiffs. It is important to focus on the fundamental fact that California has engraved discrimination on the basis of sex and sexual orientation into its fundamental governing charter. The label given to Proposition 8 in the official voters' pamphlet said it all. It eliminates the right of same-sex couples to marry. This proposition marginalized and stripped over 1 million gay and lesbian Californians of access to what the Supreme Court of the United States has repeatedly characterized as the most important relation in life.
Mr. Olson, then, you do think there's a difference between taking the right away and not affording it in the first place?
Yes, we do, Judge Reinhart. That is what the United States Supreme Court said in a case going back to Reitman versus Mulkey in 1964, where the California citizens acted through this process and took away and rights with respect to discrimination in housing. And that is what the Supreme Court said in Romer versus Colorado, that it does make a difference. Now, I don't think, as an original matter that it would be constitutional if Congress had enacted Proposition 8 5 years ago, before the In Re Marriage cases. But I think it makes it worse, and that's what the United States Supreme Court has said, the taking away of the rights in that context enhances the effect of the constitution, of the purported constitutional change.
Well, what's your answer to a case that Mr. Cooper referred to several times? It's the one about the busing and other methods of bringing diversity to the schools.
That's the Crawford case.
Yes.
And what the Crawford case did was say that to the extent not required by the Constitution, remedies for constitutional violations could be restricted by the people of the state of California. But that doesn't change anything. I heard Mr. Cooper mention the Crawford case five times. Not once in anywhere in the Crawford case does it suggest that an initiative measure somehow rises above the 14th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States. And that's certainly what the Reitman case held, and that's certainly what the Romer case.
Are you suggesting then that a gay marriage is required by the Constitution of the United States?
What is required by the Constitution of the United States is the fundamental right of its citizens to marry. Now, Mr. Cooper defined that as it has always been between a man and a woman, but the United States Supreme Court has never said that. What the United States Supreme Court has said in 14 cases involving the right to marriage, in the context of abortion, in the context of prisoners, in the context of contraception, and in the context of divorce, that the right to marry is an aspect of the right to liberty, privacy, association, and identity.
But what I'm trying to find out is your argument here, in response to Crawford, that there is a constitutional right to gay marriage. Do we have to reach that point? Because what you're answering is that they are taking away a constitutional right. And if that's your answer, fine. If not, I'd like to know that also.
No, my answer is that they are taking away a constitutional right given by the state of California, recognized by the state of California. That in and of itself makes Proposition 8 unconstitutional under Romer and Reitman. But I would also say that it is also constitutional, and I would not call it, Judge Reinhart, gay marriage, or I wouldn't call it single-sex marriage, any more than the Supreme Court of the United States called it interracial marriage. What the Supreme Court has said 14 times is that it's a right of liberty, association, privacy.
You can say whatever you want, but in deciding the case, I think we're entitled to know whether your answer to Crawford is that, yes, you can't take away a constitutional right, and this is taking away a constitutional right under the 14th Amendment.
Yes.
Okay.
I would also say
it's dependent on that.
Pardon me?
It's dependent on our finding that they would be taking away a constitution.
No, it is not, because I went on to say that the right to marriage is a right of an individual. And by the way, Mr. Cooper talks in terms of the right of society, society's interest in procreation. It is not society's right. The rights under the Constitution are not the rights of California. They're not the rights of voters of California. They're rights of citizens of the United States under the Bill of Rights and the 14th Amendment. And if California could insist that something to do with procreation be engraved onto the right of marriage, it could take that away. It could say, we're overpopulated, we don't want procreation, and we'll deny people the right to marry. This is a fundamental individual right, and what the Supreme Court said, and the reason I'm emphasizing this point, Judge Reinhart, because if you look at it from the standpoint of a right of two particular individuals, maybe they were Mr. and Mrs. Loving in the Virginia case, of an interracial marriage, it was marriage. It was their right to get together, and what the Supreme Court said in the Griswold case We deal with a right of privacy older than the Bill of Rights. Marriage is a coming together, for better or worse, hopefully enduring and intimate to the degree of being sacred. It is an association that promotes a way of life and so forth. This is from the Griswold case, one of 14.
Mr. Olson, I'm not trying to express a view on gay marriage or any marriage at this point. I'm trying to find out how far we have to go if we are to accept your view of this case. Certainly, if we start out from the assumption that everybody is entitled to marry everybody else, regardless of sex, regardless of sexual orientation, if we have to reach that issue, we would. But as you well know, as you argued the Plout case, we are advised not to reach a constitutional question unless we have to. I was not planning on reaching that question for you this early in the discussion, but it seems to come in relation to how we deal with the Crawford case. And it was for that reason that I was asking you whether, in order to distinguish Crawford, you are saying that it's necessary to take the position the only thing you can't take away as a state is a right under the 14th Amendment.
There seems to me there's two questions in that. How far you have to go and the significance of Crawford. You do not have to go any further than what the Romer case requires you to go. The Romer case says taking away the constitutional right of individuals who are homosexuals because of their classification as homosexuals violates the United States Constitution even under a rational basis test. And I would say, if I get a chance to do that, this is the clearest case I can imagine of heightened scrutiny. But in addition to that answer, which I submit, is the answer to your question, how far do we have to go? But the additional answer with respect to the Crawford case is a completely separate thing, it seems to me, because Crawford was saying, yes, the citizens can change non-constitutionally required remedies for constitutional violations. That's different than this. And so for the Crawford case, in my judgment, has nothing to do with this case, and I would be happy to put the Crawford case against the Reitman case, the Romer case, the Loving case, and Lawrence versus Texas. It cannot possibly penetrate the full weight of those four decisions. And I guess one additional answer, and I think it's important since I slipped into mentioning the Lawrence case. The United States Supreme Court has determined that intimate sexual conduct between persons of the same sex is constitutionally protected. And the Supreme Court has said, as I said, marriage is a fundamental right. How can the fundamental right of marriage be taken away by Californians from persons because they're engaged in a constitutionally protected activity? How can the constitutional right be taken away because of the constitutionally protected activity? It cannot exist. If you put the Lawrence case together with the marriage cases, Loving case, and so on and so forth, you cannot take away that right, which is not a right of same-sex persons. It's a right of all citizens, and it's a right to be with the person that they love, to have an association that they select, to live a life of privacy, to identify themselves as a self-identification, as Justice Kennedy talked about in both Romer and Lawrence. That right cannot be taken away from individuals in this state because of their sexual orientation. It is discrimination on the basis of sex, and it's discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation. And if even under rational basis test, the proponents of Proposition 8 cannot come up with a reason. They've tried various different reasons throughout the election campaign and this litigation with various different reasons. They started off with the proposition, and it's in the ballot materials, that it was necessary to protect our children from thinking that gay marriage was okay. That was the original rationalization for the statute that was in advertisements, and it's in the ballot measures submitted to the voters, protect our children from thinking that gay marriage is okay. Well, what is matter? What is the matter with that? It must be something about gay people that are getting married that would be disturbing to California voters, and you have to take that risk away from them. They basically retreated from that proposition, and it only appears on pages 107 and 108 of the brief that they filed. And basically they're now saying that it might, if gay marriage were permitted, this is what they say on page 107 or 108 or 109 of their brief, Proposition 8 needs to be enacted because the existence of same-sex marriage will somehow, they don't use the word somehow, will make children prematurely occupied with issues of sexuality. That is nonsense, that you can enact a proposition that walls off the citizens of this state from a fundamental right because you're worried that otherwise children might be prematurely preoccupied with issues of sexuality. That, of course, if that was a justification, it would equally warrant banning comic books, television, video games, and conversations with other children.
In deciding whether rational basis saves this proposition, what do we look to?
Well, whether I'm not sure your question is asking me whether it should be rational basis and what would be the justification.
Assume it's rational basis. Do we look to the record that was made in district court, or do the cases suggest to us that we imagine whether there is any conceivable rational basis and apply that?
It has to, the answer is that is too attenuated. Just to imagine something from the sky that someone might conceivably imagine. And the City of Claiborne case and the Romer case makes it clear that, and then Justice Kennedy in decision for the court in Romer case says we must look further than that. We must look into the reasons, and they must make sense, and they can't be attenuated, and they can't be motivated by fear of people that we don't like or minorities. It's got to be more than that, and most of all, it has to be rational. And that's why I was looking through the reasons that they've advanced. One is this protect our children, and we've seen, at least I think it's manifestly clear, that that is not a rational basis because you can't do that because basically that's based upon the idea that there's something wrong with these people. We must protect our children from them. That won't work.
Suppose, and just assume this for the purpose of my question, that we were to conclude that this accidental pregnancy argument is in fact a rational basis. Have the proponents of the proposition or the imperial clerk given up that argument because of the arguments they made in the political process leading up to its passage?
No, but I think that the court has to look at all of that. In the context, what the court has said, you have to look at the context in which the measure was passed. Now, I will say, if I move to that point, this concept of rational procreation, there is no way that Proposition 8 prevents, by keeping individuals of the same sex from getting married, have anything to do with heterosexual marriage. Same-sex marriage is not going to discourage heterosexual people from getting married. It is not going to keep them from getting divorced. It is not going to have any effect at all on their choice about having children. On the other hand, the elimination of Proposition 8 cannot possibly hurt the heterosexual relationship at all. In this case, the evidence was clear from the witnesses in this case that there would be no harm as a result of the elimination of Proposition 8. And Mr. Cooper, quite candidly, when he was asked that question at the summary judgment hearing, repeatedly by the district court, what harm can there be? He said, I don't know. Now, what he meant, and I'll let him speak for himself on this, but what he was saying is that we don't know the impact of allowing same-sex marriage And how it might affect this very important institution of marriage. Well, it's a very important institution of marriage because it means a great deal to the citizens of this state.
You know, people in popular election campaigns make all sort of nonsensical arguments.
I haven't heard that.
Not to vote for someone or to vote for someone. But, you know, my point is this, that my reading of these cases suggests that this is a matter of what is referred to as legislative facts, that it really matters not what a whole bunch of people might suggest one way or another. This is a sort of a legislative fact thing that we look to. And if we can conceive, it can be conceived and argued that there's a rational basis to uphold the constitutionality of Prop 8, that satisfies the test.
Well, I will have several answers to that. One, this idea of legislative facts means that instead of the witnesses that talked about the history of discrimination, the damage that discrimination has done, the immutable characteristic that we're talking about, people don't choose to become gay. They have a characteristic which this court and in the Hernandez case and the California Supreme Court has talked about. And with respect to the immutability, if I can have a slight digression, is that all of the plaintiffs and other witnesses in this case and the experts and the judge's findings suggested that this is a characteristic that's immutable. And we have all of those reasons why, and the long history of discrimination, which Mr. Cooper stipulated to at the trial, the damage that's done as a result of the discrimination, all of this requires heightened scrutiny. But if you were to go to an imagined, at a rational basis standard articulated along the lines that you did, which I don't think is the test, I don't think that's at all consistent with City of Claiborne, and it's not consistent with Romer at all. But if you were to say that, what can we imagine? What conceivable thing can we think of that would justify doing the damage that's being done to our citizens in California? What is it? I don't know what it is. It can't
Well, just a minute. Maybe I could maybe suggest a couple of things. Do you believe that the idea of distinguishing marriage from domestic partnerships in name only in order to promote it as a vehicle for procreation, responsible procreation, an inclusion of one group promotes legitimate government purpose. All things being equal, children are most likely to thrive when raised by father and mother who brought them into this world. Do you believe that that would survive rational basis review?
It would be flatly inconsistent with the evidence in this case, number one. Number two, Mr.
Well, it's slightly inconsistent with the evidence in this case if you naturally jump to the conclusion that the only evidence in this case is that which the judge has suggested is in the
well,
rather than that legislature and then the judge might find if there's evidence for it or against it. But I'm suggesting, now just sit the question. The idea of distinguishing marriage from domestic partnerships in name only to promote it as a vehicle for procreation, all else being equal, children likely to thrive when raised by father and mother who brought them into this world, that it is irrational.
Yes. In the first place, Mr. Cooper specifically said just a few moments ago, the name is the institution. Those are his words, virtually verbatim. The name is the institution, and the witnesses at this trial, the witnesses that came forward and were willing to be cross-examined and willing to testify under oath, not the law review articles and so forth that were put in by the proponents, but the witnesses that came forward in this case and the plaintiffs and other witnesses in this case talked about what marriage meant to them and what it means in this society as an institution, not just what the Supreme Court said, but we had what the plaintiffs said, what the experts said, what the Supreme Court said, and what the district court found. And there's nothing that would suggest that children thrive in a better way in that environment. In fact, the the proponent's expert, Mr. Blankenhorn, testified that the children in those relationships would be better off, that we would be a better country, we would be closer to the American ideal if same-sex marriage were permitted. Now, it's easy to say those things, that you have to have a better situation where a child is in with a mother and a father, but allowing the other problem with that is that the remedy doesn't fit the so-called problem. In other words, restricting marriage to people of opposite sex doesn't mean that there won't be people in same-sex marriages. That California permits that. And the court, there's something like 37,000 children in same-sex households in California today. There are also 18,000 same-sex marriages which are not at issue in this case. It's easy to say that children would be better off in that relationship, but if you have heterosexual relationships permitted in California and marriages between persons of the same sex, it doesn't change where the children will be raised. If a child is a product of a biological relationship between a man and a woman, that's up to that man and that woman to keep them together. I think Judge Reinhardt suggested that a better remedy for that would be prohibit divorce, but that's not something that Californians are interested in doing.
Are we free to use anything other than the rational basis test in the Ninth Circuit?
Oh, yes, I believe very strongly that you are. The Hernandez case talks about immutability. To the extent that you're referring to any other aspect of the doctrine of heightened standard, I think that has been ventilated, and the issues that would support an enhanced heightened scrutiny are all present, and you would be bound by what the Supreme Court has said with respect to that.
How about our Witt case?
I think the Witt case supports exactly what I was just saying.
The factual circumstance, you argue factual circumstances are different in Witt and high-tech gays, but I guess, do you have authority that the factual circumstances alone would allow us to make a different holding than a prior three-judge panel?
I think that the Hernandez case, which is a subsequent decision, already addresses that issue, and I think the case that Judge Reinhardt focused on involving the federal public defender, I think it was Levinson, also addressed that point.
It wasn't the case, unfortunately, but it was an administrative ruling.
Well, I thought the wisdom in that case was superb, Your Honor. and the reasoning, I think, in that, I couldn't do a better job in answering the earlier question than the reasoning set forth in writing in that case. And with respect to the Baker case, the Supreme Court has made it very clear that when the facts are different, and the precise issue is not the same. Sexual orientation was not presented in that case. That was strictly a gender case, not a sexual orientation case. The facts here are different, not just the Romer situation where California has recognized same-sex marriages and then has taken it away, but California has an interesting crazy quilt system of laws in this state with respect to marriage. Some people may be married because they're heterosexual, and some people may not be married because they wish to marry someone of the same sex. Some people who were married to someone of the same sex may stay married, but if they were to get a divorce, they couldn't even remarry the same person. And some persons that are out of state, and if their marriage is legal outside the state, then they are recognized in California. We have an irrational system here. And finally, with respect to the Baker case, the doctrinal ground has changed because of the Supreme Court's sex discrimination cases, and it's changed with respect to the Romer case, and it's changed with respect to Lawrence versus Texas. What this case comes down to, it seems to me, that California has built a fence around its gay and lesbian citizens. And it's built a fence around the institution of marriage, which the Supreme Court says, not based upon sex or procreation or anything else, is the most important relation in life. and the citizens of California within that one fence, because of their sexual orientation, are denied access to what every other citizen in California has that are enclosed within that other fence. That is a violation of the Equal Protection Clause, and it's a violation of the Due Process Clause.
Are we free, in view of the way the Supreme Court has told us, to decide constitutional issues, that the broadest should be avoided, the narrowest should be adopted? Are we free to do anything other than decide the issue of whether California's repeal of an initiative constitutes a violation? Your closing speech would require a holding that any state that did not permit gay marriage would be in violation of the Constitution. There is a possibility, I think, in this case, of saying that Proposition 8's withdrawal of the right of gay marriage from gays and lesbians is unconstitutional under the circumstances that they enjoyed that right, that they are given every other aspect of marriage, and all that is taken away is the honorific designation. Are we free to go beyond a holding, if we were to rule in your favor, a holding that the repeal of the right to marriage, the right to use the label marriage and to receive a certificate, that under those circumstances, it's a violation? Can we, in view of Plout and similar cases, go farther than that?
I don't think, by the way, you mentioned that I was involved in that case. I don't think that case in any way should inhibit you from doing what I think is, I think the answer to your question is that you could decide this on the narrow ground that the Romer case gives to you, put into conjunction with In Re Marriage from the California Supreme Court. But I think this case is, I don't think there's anything in the United States Supreme Court jurisprudence, including the Prout case or anything else, that suggests that you can't look at the larger the constitutional question, which that earlier question is subsumed within. What are the right, what has California done? California has taken a class of citizens and put them in a separate category, whether they had a different category before or not. And that act of discrimination, there's no doubt that it is discrimination. And there's no doubt that it does great harm. The only question is, can it be justified under any standard of constitutional analysis? And I submit that it cannot be justified under any standard of constitutional analysis, because at the lowest standard, rational basis, you'd have to know what is rational. And all of the arguments that my opponent is making with respect to how valuable the institution of marriage is are not rational when it comes to the reason of the question of, well, why did you draw that line? Heterosexual people are different than homosexual people. Gays and lesbians are different than straight people, to use the vernacular. But that does not mean you can classify them, as to use Justice Kennedy's words in Romer, and then exclude them from this life of this part of society. So the rational basis analysis has to go to the justification for the exclusion. What goal is California trying to accomplish, and what it has accomplished in Proposition 8, does it pursue those goals in a proper way? That's where the rational basis falls completely down. You might say left-handed people or colorblind people, you might make some distinctions, but if you're saying they can't participate in a right because of an immutable characteristic, you have not only a due process violation, but an equal protection violation. And ultimately, that's the decision I'd like to see this court issue.
Thank you, Mr. Olson.
Thank you.
Ms. Stewart?
Thank you. May it please the court. I want to focus on the circumstances in the context particular to California that show how singularly irrational Proposition 8 really is. First, and there are four things, but the first I want to talk about is that it imposes a special disability on gay people for reasons that California has disavowed, and that it doesn't attempt to pursue in any other arena. California regulates child rearing and parentage separately from marriage, and Proposition 8 has nothing to do with trying to promote one family for raising children over another. Besides that, California laws that do govern parenting and child rearing provide in every way, the California law continues to recognize that same-sex couples and opposite-sex couples are the same for purposes of family and child rearing in every way that matters. As the California Supreme Court held in Strauss, the Proposition 8 didn't change any of that. It didn't talk about children. It had nothing to do with the rights of gay people to form and raise families.
Are we talking about a label here?
We are talking about a label, Your Honor, but it's a very important label. It does have great meaning, and I think both sides of the table would stipulate to that, and I think the amount spent on this measure is testament to it. And so that leads to my second point, which is the proposition.
The reason I asked that question is, and it follows on a question that my colleague Judge Smith asked the other side, and that's this. Is a state which allows, as California apparently does, everything short of the label in a better position to enact a Proposition 8 than a state which allows none of it?
Your Honor, I don't think it's in a better position or a worse position, but what I would say is this. I mean, we agree with plaintiffs, and we tried the case with them, that treating same-sex couples differently in regard to family is unconstitutional across the board. But what happens here in California when you have the panoply of parentage laws and family-related laws that treat couples exactly the same, that underscores the irrationality of the measure. And here,
How?
Because family law in California both recognizes that gay people do procreate, allows them to use assisted reproduction in the same way that heterosexual people do, treats their families the same way for establishing parentage. For example, when it figures out who are the parents of a child, the sex and sexual orientation is irrelevant to the determination. It recognizes that both heterosexual people and, sadly, gay people as well can be irresponsible and walk away from their children. It doesn't matter how the child comes into the world. Parents do that all the time, and the state's interest is exactly the same.
But nonetheless, if the rational basis is that to do this in name only is to promote it simply as a vehicle for procreation, then doesn't that survive the rational basis test?
It does not, Your Honor, for two reasons. One, first of all, same-sex couples do procreate. They don't do it the old-fashioned way, to use terminology from one of our cases, but they do procreate. And California doesn't discourage that in any way or say one is preferable over the other. But if you were to think that excluding same-sex couples would somehow encourage heterosex couples to procreate in some different way or to be more responsible for their children, you have to assume that there's some reason that including gay people will make heterosexual people less likely to carry out their parental duties. And the only way you can get there is to assume that somehow the association of gay men and lesbians with marriage taints the institution. And that is not a basis on which equal protection allows the state to enact laws. So I don't think it does work, Your Honor. It's not rational, and it is the only way it can be understood is saying there's something so wrong with gay people that they put a stain on marriage, and they'll make heterosexual people therefore avoid being married. And equal protection doesn't allow that. So Proposition 8 regulates the title and the stature only, as the ballot pamphlet pointed out. And, you know, William Eskridge filed a brief on behalf of some law professors, and he said something that I think really says it better than I can, which is that the fact that Proposition 8 is largely symbolic and leaves rights in place while eliminating stature makes the insult that the measure visits on lesbian and gay couples obvious. What Prop 8 really is doing is the state commanding that we call gay relationships different, even as it treats them the same. And that's kind of the quintessential classification undertaken for its own sake. The third point is that Strauss held that the way that Proposition 8 did what it did was that it carved out an exception to the equal protection, privacy, and due process clauses of our state constitution. And that's pretty extraordinary. It made our equal protection clause in our state constitution unequal. And Romer tells us that with discrimination of an unusual character, you have to be especially careful to consider whether it's obnoxious to equal protection. Now, any of those features that I mentioned alone would make, I think, the court have to have pause in looking at Prop 8. But when you take them together, they leave Prop 8 inexplicable by anything other than animus towards the class. But here there's a fourth point, and that is that the court doesn't have to infer animus. The context of the measure itself and the campaign really demonstrate that the purpose of the campaign was to be sure that proponents avoided associating marriage with lesbian and gay couples because it would demean the institution. It was bias. The voters amended the Constitution, the state Constitution, to incorporate the measure after California Supreme Court rejected it on state constitutional grounds. Why? Because it demeaned gay people. It treated them as second-class citizens. It relegated them to an inferior status. The voters, the campaign didn't say to the voters, well, gee, the court got that wrong. The campaign said to the voters, we have to put them in an inferior status, because if we don't, everybody won't, we need children and everybody else to recognize that that same-sex couples are different. They're not the same as opposite-sex couples, and they're not okay. And it portrayed opposite-sex couples as traditional and ideal, and it portrayed gay couples as a lifestyle that should be kind of kept in private. And the campaign leaders, after the campaign, wrote an article in which they said they deliberately tapped into voters' limited tolerance for gay people. The campaign went about portraying gay
Give
people.
You another 30 seconds, you're over. You voluntarily gave up some time.
Let me just say, Your Honor, close with this. Proponents say that in order to affirm the district court, this court must find that the majority who voted for Proposition 8 are bigots, and that is not so. Prejudice, which Cleburne defined as the belief that one group is less worthy or less deserving than others, is not always born of hatred. It may, as Justice Kennedy said in Garrett, be the result of a simple want of careful, rational reflection or an instinct to guard against people that we think are different from ourselves. That sort of intent was what was underneath Prop 8. It's plain from the face of it. It's plain from the campaign. And equal protection doesn't allow the state to enact a measure based on a view that some people are unworthy. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel. Mr. Cooper.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just a few moments, if you will, please indulge me. First, Mr. Olson spoke of the Loving case at great length, but we know that if Mr. Loving had desired to marry Mr. Jeter, that the case would not have come out the same way. We know that with certainty, because Baker against Nelson rejected that very claim, and it rejected that claim on the heels of Loving, where the gay couple who brought that 14th Amendment Loving claim relied on Loving very heavily. We also think that Mr. Olson is simply wrong when he suggests that the Baker case did not involve a claimed classification based upon sexual orientation that was just gender. Here's what the plaintiffs in Baker said. There is no justification, and this is throughout their jurisdictional statement, Your Honor. There is no justification in law for the discrimination against homosexuals. Appellants are being deprived of a basic right, the right to marry. As a result of this deprivation, they have been denied numerous benefits awarded by law to others similarly situated, dash, for example, childless heterosexual couples. This was clearly a case where they challenged the classification as one based upon sexual orientation as well as one based on gender. The Loving case would have been on all fours, would have come out, excuse me, the Baker case would have been on all fours with Loving if it were a fact that same-sex sexual relations produced children the same as opposite-sex sexual relations do. Then Mr. Olson's would have a lay-down case. There would be no basis on which to draw a distinction, to identify a distinguishing characteristic with respect to any interest that the state has the authority to implement. There would be no difference. And so the question is, does the state, does society have no interest in that distinguishing characteristic? We submit to you.
Is there a case that suggests that, or is that good argument? Do you have a case to suggest that's the distinguishing characteristic, or is that good argument?
I think it's both, Your Honor.
Well, I guess I'd like the case.
The case I am referring to is the Garrett case, which sets forward the standard that I just quoted, and it in turn is quoting the Cleburne case, both of which applied rational basis review and upheld distinctions where they were drawn on distinguishing characteristics. I would also offer to the court as well the Johnson against Robeson case, where the court said, when inclusion of one group promotes or addresses a state interest and the addition of others would not, then the state is justified in acting upon those differences in drawing that classification. I would like to also refer the court very quickly here. Well, let me just.
Nothing's been done very quickly here.
I'm sorry.
Said nothing's been done very quickly here, but
and the court,
when you're in the red, that doesn't mean you have that much time remaining.
Fair enough. If the court will just give me 30 seconds, because this is a point that is clearly very much on the mind of the court, and that's the Romer case. I want to share this passage with you from Romer. Yet Amendment 2, in explicit terms, does more than repeal or rescind these provisions. It prohibits all legislative, executive, or judicial action at any level of state or local government designed to protect the named class, a class we shall refer to as homosexual persons. The point is that Amendment 2 was unprecedented, it was extraordinary, and whether it had repealed anything or not, standing essentially in its own shoes without regard to what the history behind it was, it was unconstitutional. It would have been unconstitutional if it had singled out and made a stranger to the law any class of persons. Again, Your Honor, thank you very much for your indulgence.
Thank you very much. Thank all of you for a fascinating argument. The court will stand adjourned.
All rise.
Fourth Amendment rights and illegal search and seizure, Saturday on C-SPAN Radio's landmark Supreme Court cases.
Although they claim that there was a search warrant, there was absolutely no evidence of any